anesthesia. When you are receiving general anesthesia, it is not uncommon to be taken to the operating room with or without relaxing medicine, such as midazolam, or a pain medication such as fentanyl. Upon arrival to the operating room, you may or may not be asked to move to another bed, which you may be aware at the time you're doing it, but may be unable to recall later. And then multiple monitors will be placed on you prior to fully going to sleep. Propofol is the most common intravenous medication used in adults to get patients asleep and into general anesthesia. However, in young children, it is very common to take them to the operating room with no IV and have them breathe volatile anesthetic, or commonly known by the lay public as gas, to get them asleep and then put in an IV if it is more than a brief procedure or surgery. Most adult patients are transitioned to receiving a gas, such as sevoflurane, after receiving propofol. Propofol is a quick-on, quick-off medication and would need to be continuously administered through the IV to remain asleep. It can be significantly easier to administer and titrate gas for longer procedures. Side effects from propofol are rare, but side effects from the gas, strong painkillers like opioids, and a few other anesthesia-specific drugs can cause nausea, which is why nearly all patients who receive anesthesia automatically receive an anti-nausea medication prior to finishing anesthesia. Other potential side effects from anesthesia can include allergic reactions, headaches, confusion, double vision, and drowsiness. A rare life-threatening reaction to anesthesia, known as malignant hyperthermia, requires special treatment, and any history of this in the patient or blood-related family members should be shared as soon as possible with the surgeon and anesthesiologist prior to going to surgery. If a general anesthetic is chosen, it is typically delivered via a more specialized airway device, frequently called a laryngeal mask airway, or LMA. The placement of an LMA does not require finding the vocal cords. The LMA just sits behind and a little below the tongue, but above the vocal cords. It's rare to have a sore throat, but some mild irritation for a day or two may be noticed. In fact, I find that most patients were unaware that they had something in their throat when they speak of their prior surgeries. I remind patients that they really don't want anyone in the room breathing the same gas that they are breathing, or we could have a problem. Containing that gas in a tube for just the patient is really the ideal situation. This is also important to contain higher levels of oxygen from being exposed to any nearby cautery, which some surgeons need to control bleeding. If any stomach acid was to come up, then an LMA does not protect the patient from aspiration. This is why an anesthesia provider is there to ensure you have not had anything to eat or drink within the prescribed time frame, and to ensure your safety by suctioning any contents from your mouth, throat, or trachea in the rare case of regurgitation, and then place a breathing tube to keep you safe. In the video, you will see that I am being given propofol, and I suddenly look lifeless. The anesthesiologist temporarily helped me breathe with the mask, and then again with the LMA until I could begin breathing again on my own, which occurs as the propofol wears off. I was not paralyzed for the placement of the LMA. You will notice that I was responding to the LMA because my nervous system is still able to react to things done to me, but I was unaware of what I was doing, nor did I have any recall. During the surgery, my eyes were lightly taped to avoid my eyes from drying out and to avoid corneal abrasions, which are scratches on the eyeball. Those that get scratches on the eye usually occur when the patient is not aware what they are doing and can scratch themselves, and many times the patient is rubbing their eyes or nose as they are starting to wake up. Upon removal of the LMA, you will notice some lovely saliva, which is normal. If you are having a surgery that requires a regular breathing tube or you have a high risk of aspiration, then a special instrument is used to open your mouth to see the vocal cords to place the breathing tube, also known as the endotracheal tube, gently between the cords. This is the standard laryngoscope or instrument used to open patients' mouths. In the video, the patient consented to videotaping, but the eyes were covered for privacy reasons. After propofol and pain medication such as fentanyl is given, a paralytic or paralyzing medication is given to allow the vocal cords to relax and open for intubation. For the purposes of showing you a better picture, a video scope, which is useful for patients whose vocal cords are difficult to see with a standard instrument, was used. A rigid stylet may or may not be used for intubation depending on the circumstance and provider preference. The stylet in the endotracheal tube or breathing tube allows the tip of the tube to enter up and into the trachea via the vocal cords with more leverage. The stylet is removed after the tube is introduced into the top of the trachea. It is not necessary to keep the stylet in the endotracheal tube as the tube is being pushed down into the trachea. Paralyzing medications may be needed for the surgery itself at times, but many times it is only used for placing the breathing tube. The fear of being awake and not being able to move is extremely rare and usually found in compromising situations of already low blood pressure in some pregnant women, some heart bypass surgeries, or trauma situations. It is not uncommon for general anesthesia to cause a mild drop in blood pressure, and so the further drops in blood pressure from these low blood pressure scenarios mentioned can compromise a patient's organs such as the brain and/or a fetus. During general anesthesia, your vital signs such as your blood pressure, heart rate, oxygen levels, etc. are monitored continuously by the anesthesia provider while the surgeon does surgery. Dosing of any antibiotics is discussed with the surgeon prior to incision, if they are needed. An operating room nurse assists both the surgeon and anesthesia provider to ensure patient safety as well. It is fairly common in many surgeries to place compressive socks and/or devices on the lower legs of patients to prevent blood clots, to add special warmers to keep patients warm in a colder environment while receiving anesthesia, as you do lose some heat when your veins dilate from the gas anesthesia, and sometimes place a catheter in the bladder to drain urine for longer surgeries or special cases.